Nous allons débuter immédiatement ce congrès virtuel. Bonjour tout le monde, bienvenue à cette 5e édition, 2e édition virtuelle du congrès annuel de Ski Québec Alpin. 8 conférences, 8 conférenciers. On est déjà dans la deuxième et dernière fin de semaine. J'espère que vous avez été présents lors des deux premières. On a eu beaucoup de belles discussions avec les spécialistes, avec les athlètes, également de table ronde, avec quelques athlètes qu'évidemment notre invité d'aujourd'hui connaît. Ça avait été également très, très intéressant. Alors, on poursuit aujourd'hui avec 4 conférences. Et on commence avec l'entraîneur-chef Tim Kfeller. On va passer un petit peu devant ces invitations. Bien sûr, on sait très bien que c'est la situation qui nous oblige un peu à faire ces conférences virtuelles, mais vous êtes très nombreux, plus nombreux que si on le faisait en présentiel, donc je pense que c'est une routine qui va s'installer tranquillement. Bien sûr, on est content du déconfinement. Ça fonctionne de cette façon-là pour ceux qui ne le savent pas, donc vos micros et vos vidéos sont déjà désactivés, alors pas de panique si votre enfant ou si votre colocataire décide de faire du bruit, pas de problème. Par contre, lorsque ce sera la période des questions, bien, on pourra ouvrir les micros en cas de besoin. On n'aura qu'à lever la main pour le faire. Mais tout au long de la conférence, vous pouvez poser vos questions, mais on va n'y répondre seulement qu'à la fin. Donc, mais vous pouvez les poser. Et ça, Tim insiste là-dessus. On va lui parler dans quelques instants, mais il dit, si jamais vous avez des questions qui n'ont pas de lien avec la conférence qu'il va donner, il est plus que disponible. Alors, si vous avez une question qui touche un autre aspect de ce qui pourrait l'intéresser comme spécialiste, n'hésitez pas à poser la question. Alors, c'est donc le fonctionnement du système norvégien par Tim Kfeller. C'est un entraîneur-chef de l'équipe technique des Dames de la Norvège, une des meilleures équipes au monde, ça va de soi. Il cumule à son actif près de 28 ans dans sa carrière d'entraîneur de ski alpin. Il a été entraîneur de l'équipe du Québec, on en parlait il y a un instant, entre 2004 et 2006. Après ça, il est allé passer deux séjours avec Canada Alpin. Et il est maintenant en Norvège depuis 7 ans. Et on le dit, hein, l'équipe féminine qu'il représente, technique, c'est 8 skieuses, 14 entraîneurs, techniciens avec lui. Et ils connaissent passablement de succès. Alors, c'est intéressant d'avoir un Canadien né, élevé à Ottawa, qui a grandi et qui a expérimenté son stage d'entraîneur au Québec et au Canada. Puis aujourd'hui, domine pratiquement le monde avec son équipe norvégienne. Alors, on va parler justement du système norvégien. Alors, Tim Kfeller, bonjour.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. Alors, oui, mais vous avez quand même passé quelques temps au Québec. Je sais que la conférence sera en anglais, puis c'est absolument correct. Peut-être quelques mots sur votre appréciation du ski québécois et vos années ici.
Oui, merci. Oui, pour commencer, oui, je parle français, mais ça fait 8 ans que je ne parle pas beaucoup de français. Alors, pour moi, pour m'exprimer dans le ski, avec le ski, c'est beaucoup plus facile en anglais.
Oui.
Non, j'étais à Québec pendant plusieurs ans.
Oui.
Moi, j'ai commencé mon carrière à Ottawa avec l'équipe NCO, que tout le monde, je pense, connaît. Et j'étais là pour 9 ans avec l'équipe NCO, puis j'ai passé à l'équipe du Québec pour 3 ans, un an comme assistant et 2 ans comme responsable de l'équipe des garçons. Et là, j'ai passé à Alpine Canada, et c'était juste une fois que j'étais à Alpine Canada, mais c'était pour 8 ans. Alors, j'ai fait 2 ans avec la Coupe du Monde, 2 ans avec l'équipe de développement, puis là, j'ai passé encore à la Coupe du Monde avec ses athlètes, une autre 4 ans. Okay. Et maintenant, j'ai commencé après Sochi, 2014, en Norvège. Alors, ça fait 7 ans que je suis ici, je commence mon 8e année ici. Et je suis l'entraîneur-chef du programme Coupe du Monde en Norvège.
Alors, bravo, bravo. Puis bravo pour votre français que vous n'avez pas trop perdu. Au contraire, il est très impressionnant. Et comme vous me disiez juste avant qu'on entre officiellement en ligne, les occasions que vous avez maintenant, c'est lors des Coupes du Monde, lors des étapes françaises. C'est à peu près les seules occasions que vous avez. Mais bravo et continuez de le perfectionner. Et on vous souhaite bien sûr grand succès. Je pense que le travail d'équipe dans le ski alpin est très important. C'est un peu l'objet de votre conférence pour avoir regardé des petits bouts d'une conférence précédente. Je pense que tout le monde à l'écoute présentement a très hâte de vous entendre et j'en profite peut-être une dernière fois avant de vous laisser toute la place et votre présentation de bien inscrire votre code ACA pour, ou PNCE là, pour obtenir les points nécessaires à tous les entraîneurs et membres qui ont besoin de ces points-là. Alors, bonne conférence. On est vraiment à votre écoute, tout le monde. Et encore une fois, si vous avez des questions par la suite, n'hésitez pas à les poser. À vous.
Super, merci. Do I just push this share screen button?
Yes, that's it.
Great. Super. It'll just take me a second here. Sorry. Okay, can you see it okay?
It's perfect.
Yeah, and can you hear me okay as well?
Yeah, everything's perfect.
All right, super. Thanks a lot for the introduction. I apologize, we're not doing this in French, but like we talked about earlier, I speak French, it seems twice a year now, once in Courchevel and once in Val d'Isère. And so it's a lot easier for me to express myself about skiing and what I want to talk about in English. And I think it'll be better in the end for everybody as well. A couple of things. First of all, my webcam is at the bottom of my screen. So if it looks like I'm looking in a funny direction, it's not really the case. It's just that camera's at the bottom of the screen. So when Eric asked me to do a presentation here, I wasn't exactly sure what to talk about in terms of the Norwegian system and how we do things here. But I think I'm not going to get too much into the technical details of skiing and exactly what we do on snow, but more about how we function as a team and the common threads that sort of run through the Norwegian system and Norwegian culture. I also struggled with the title of the presentation, but Norwegian team building through the eyes of a Canadian. I think the key word there is team, and that's going to be Norwegian, they call it a red thread, something that runs through everything. And I think that the word team is going to run through a lot today. The presentation is not super long. It's part of it is a presentation I did earlier in the season with some, and I'll go through what we're going to cover, but with just some expanding on that a little bit more. So it's not super long, but for me, it's I'm interested to know what you guys want to know also. So that's why it's really important for me that we have some questions at the end, some discussion. And like Mark mentioned before, it doesn't have to have anything to do with the presentation today. It can be really anything that you want to know. Now's the chance. So I feel like I'm at my best when I'm asked questions. And it's also great for me too, because the more I talk about skiing and the more I answer those questions and the more I get thinking also. And I have no doubt that I'm going to come out of today with some great ideas for the future. So I think that's about it in terms of the introduction. Basically today, I wanted to just go through briefly ski racing in Norway, just a little bit how the system works. It's not anything too special or shattering, but just so that everyone knows exactly sort of how it works in this country for ski racing. And then that's not super long because there's no big secrets there. Then I thought I'd go through what I've learned and what I feel is important. For clubs and teams, and again, that's some of the common threads through Norway, and whether it's the clubs, whether it's ski gymnasiums, or whether it's the national team. And then I thought I'd expand on that a little bit on how we apply these principles to our World Cup team, and how we try to develop the culture and the team that we want with this group of athletes. And then, of course, the questions and discussion at the end. So. Let's get started then. Ski racing in Norway. It's ski racing is club based for ages below U16. So I guess U12, U14, U16. It's club based, and everybody basically stays in their own regions. There's of course races, but nobody really does any traveling at that time. Once they reach a fist age, then it's also of course the clubs as well, but then they have opportunity to go to ski gymnasiums. And basically what a ski gymnasium is a team you can, it doesn't have to be from your region, but it's a team that combines the sport and the school, and it's basically a full-time program. So when you're a FIS age athlete, then you have the ability to go to ski gymnasiums. And we have three or four major ones in Norway that house, you know, most of the ski gymnasium athletes. However, a lot of athletes will stay also in their clubs. I would say that on my team at the moment, I would have about half the World Cup team comes from clubs, about half from ski gymnasiums. At all levels then, there's experienced professional full-time coaches at every level, all the way down to the young athletes. And these are, very experienced people, many that have been with the national team in the past and that have quite a bit of experience through their career. And so I think some of the best coaches that Norway has are in the younger ages. What the Norwegian Ski Federation does, so our version of Alpine Canada, is in the end not a ton, not a lot, not that much in terms of the younger athletes below the national team. We do run speed camps for the athletes, and we look after the Ironman testing. I'll get to the Ironman in a little bit as to what that is. The Norwegian Ski Federation looks after that. And then, a few things here and there, such as children's races, World Junior Championships, that sort of thing. But basically, things are left in the clubs and in the ski gymnasiums. Then, of course, we have the national teams, both men and women. Both teams have A, B, and C status athletes. A and B status athletes are World Cup athletes, and then C status athletes are European Cup athletes. And we go through a fairly, I would say, simple selection process for that to bring in. And interestingly, this is essentially the first time in Norway that they experience a selection. So there's no selections for ski gymnasiums or clubs. There's no selection for races, with the possible exception of a Whistler Cup type race. But there's no selection for races. There's really no selection done at all until they're selected for our Europa Cup team. And then it's fairly simple from our side. It's basically coach's discretion who we feel is going to have success at the European Cup. And then selection under the World Cup team is one of two ways. You're either a top 30 World Cup start list athlete, or if you come from the European Cup team, you are top three in the discipline standing from the year before. So, like I was telling Mark and Eric earlier, we had Mark Tomonsen last year in the Europa Cup, who I think was fourth in the Europa Cup standings in GS by 1 point, but she didn't then make the World Cup team. So then she went back then and won the GS title this year, so she's now part of the World Cup team. So selections are fairly simple and straightforward, and there's not a lot there. But I think what's really interesting in Norway is not so much the way the clubs and the system is set up, but it's really the culture of sport and outdoor living in Norway. It's obviously cross-country skiing is a religion here, similar, I guess, to hockey in Canada, but it's really about being outdoors and sport. And I think competitive athletes are really looked up to here in this country, no matter what sport they're from, because I mean, especially now in the pandemic, we've had the lockdown. It's no problem for Norwegians because they basically just spend their time outside in the forest, running or roller skiing or doing whatever outside, and hiking in the mountains. And so, I really think that it's part of this culture of sport and outdoor living in Norway that drives a lot of the success in skiing. I mean, I can drive, I'm at our office right now, which was about a 15-minute drive, and I probably almost ran over about six 70-year-old guys roller skiing down the street. And that's just how it is here. And I think that plays a big role in the success of the sport here. And it's also the availability of ski training. And I know that we talk a lot about the fact that young athletes don't need to ski so much, et cetera, et cetera. But I think when the availability of ski training is here, the clubs and ski gymnasiums take advantage of it. And we have two glaciers here in Norway. Well, first of all, we have the ski resorts are really excellent training until the end of April and middle of May. And so most clubs will take advantage of that. We also do that with our national team athletes and basically train them through until the first week of May. But then the glaciers that the two glaciers we have, Juvas and Fuglefauna, are each, okay, Fauna is a little further, but they're 4 or 5 hours drive from Oslo. So the clubs will take advantage of this and go almost every weekend through until the end of June. July is a sacred month in Norway. It's holiday time, so nobody skis in July. But they'll generally ski every weekend in June. And then be back at school and dry land during the week. So they ski a lot, and I think that has a big effect on it. But for me, those are the two big factors in Norway that produce a lot of good sports results with the winter sports. So I took, just out of interest for you, I took a screenshot. It's a little bit difficult to see because the resolution isn't very good. But that's the Juvas Glacier, and that's this morning, just before 9 o'clock. And I get every night, I get the Coursera, the lane sheet for the next day. And so it's a little bit hard to see, but on this glacier was 4 Super Gs and 20 GSs today. So pretty much every club is there, every ski gymnasium is there. Fuglefauna, the other glacier, is going to be just as busy. It's definitely a long weekend in Norway, so it's a holiday weekend. And so people go for 3 or 4 days of training and then go back for school and dry land. And, but that's just how busy it gets on the glaciers right now, and they do ski quite a bit. So that's a short rundown of how things work in Norway in terms of the clubs and the Ski Federation. If you have any questions after, that's no problem. Okay, so I thought I'd run through then a few things that I've learned over the years. Part of it's from Norway, but part of it's from my other experiences as well. I think being in Norway for the last 7 or 8 years and also being so close to some incredible athletes, both not only on my team, but also on the women's team or on the men's team, has definitely shaped how I see things in skiing and ski racing. So definitely quite a bit of it comes from Norway. And so I thought I'd just run through a few things that I feel would be great for clubs and teams and the like below a national team. And the first thing is the culture of the club and the team. Culture is a huge word in Norway. It's something that we talk a lot about, and it's something that we spend a lot of time on with the team. And whether it's clubs here or all the way up to the World Cup team, and basically it starts with a set of values and what you and your club membership or athletes stand for, almost like a mission statement. It's really something that set of values that something simple that guides basically everybody on the team, and something that you can always return back to in times of need. And I think that it's really the foundation of our team, our culture, and how we operate as a team. And because the team is not just a group of people, it's really a family, and that's how we see ourselves. As really a family that happens to travel and work together. And I think some simple things can be really effective in terms of culture building. And one example I have is the Ironman program in Norway. What the Ironman is a physical test or a group of physical tests that's done over one day. And so I'm kind of embarrassed to say I can't remember, but I think it's 8 different tests. And I'm not going to lie, it's quite an unpleasant day. And and the tests are not fancy. They're tests that have probably been around for years and years and years. So it's not a battery of, there's not a group of tests that's exactly rooted in science. So it's not like we're doing their VO2, or it's not like we're doing a Wingate with them. We're just doing very basic tests. But the reason we have this program is more for a culture thing. And it's, like I said, it's a day long, basically, and it's very unpleasant. And but we want the athletes to be able to push themselves to the limit. And it's something that they've instituted, and this was instituted before I arrived in Norway, throughout the entire country. And it's at the end of the day, you get a certain score. You get a 600, 700, 800, 900, 1,000. I think the record is just a little bit over 1,000, which was done by Thea Stiernesen, number 12 here on the picture. But it's something that that every club in Norway does. And it's a system that's administered and done by the Ski Federation. And it's grown from this small little project into this unbelievable culture builder. And everybody does it. Everybody talks about it. All athletes want to have the best scores possible. I talked about our selection guidelines earlier. It is actually part of our selection guidelines. So to compete at a World Cup race, you need 600 Ironman points, and to compete at a European Cup race, you need 500 Ironman points. So it's really woven into our culture, and it's something that's done from the youngest, well, not the youngest ages, but from quite young all the way up to the top stars on the World Cup teams. And so it's really something that connects the young athletes together with the older athletes, something that they can compare themselves directly to the World Cup stars. So a young 13 or 14 year old can compare themselves to Thea Stiernesen or to Kjetil Jansrud or whoever. So simple things like that can be really effective in terms of building the culture. And it's actually something now that's been copied by 3 or 4 different nations along the way. I'll go into more specifics about how we address these issues on our team specifically. To promote the club and the team and not the individual. Of course, ski racing is an individual sport. You don't go down the course together. Well, maybe in ski cross you do, but not in alpine ski racing. But it's really a team sport. And Kjetil Jansrud's famous comment is that skiing is a team sport except for the 1 or 2 minutes that you're racing down the course. And it's really true. I think that it's important to promote the team and not the individuals. It doesn't matter what team it is, even up to our World Cup teams, there's no one person that's bigger than the team. And one of the biggest driving forces of that in the last years has been Aksel Lundsvinde. He was a huge believer in this, that the team was the most important. And you know, the number of times that he was offered his own program or something special, he didn't want any of that. He wanted to work out in the gym with the youngest athletes coming into the Europa Cup team at the same time and just be together as one team. And so I think that it's not that obvious in our sport that the team can play such a huge role. But it can, and I think that's one advantage that we have over certain Central European nations, for example. And so even at the World Cup level, we make decisions based on the team and not necessarily the individuals. Of course, there are individual differences in people's programs, that's clear, but really the team comes first, and I think everyone really buys into that in Norway here. This is a huge factor. Then to decide how you want to develop athletes. Every area has its challenges, every area has its advantages. And I think it's Canada in particular has quite a few challenges with the geography of the country, different cultures throughout the country, different languages, and different ways of doing things. And but I think it's important also to look at the advantages and what the advantages are of your region or your area. And I think everywhere is going to be a little bit different. And I think that's why it's very important that we can talk, for example, today, we can talk about how things are done in Norway and what we do in Norway, but that's not necessarily going to apply somewhere else. You cannot just copy and paste programs. And I think that it's important to take the advantages out or the positive things that will work for your area or your team, but to really make your own path. And I think we've had quite a few people into Norway asking, what's the secret or how do you do it or whatever, but it really isn't. I mean, there is no secret. I mean, we look at the advantages we have. We have several things that we feel are important, and we go after those. And so I think that it's really difficult to copy and paste program, different parts of programs. You really have to go and make your own path. I think it's really important to make smart athletes. That's something that we try to talk about quite a bit, the ownership of their program. And we'll talk about that in more detail later about how we do that on our team. But in the end, it's important, and this can start right from the young ages, to really make smart athletes and teach them, and not just tell and have them do, but to make them understand. I think today's athlete at the World Cup level is different than athletes from maybe years ago. Athletes are more informed, they're more access to technology, and they really, if they're going to make the jumps that we need, they need to take ownership of their programs and take ownership of their career at this level. And I think that really starts with trying to develop the smartest athletes we can. I think that's, at our level at the World Cup, that's really how they're going to take the next step. And it's them that takes that step. It's not us that gives them that opportunity, although we'd love to think it was, but in the end, it's them that takes that step. And I think really to prepare your athletes for the future, to what lies down the road. For me, the successful mark of a coach is not how many athletes they put into the next level. It's really how those athletes fare at the next level. So, to prepare the athletes and to develop them for the future and for the next level. Okay. Then, in terms of planning, here with us, this is a huge part of our program, and it's really the biggest part of the work. In the program, it's we spend a lot of time with our team planning, both on the men's side and the women's side, together with the coaches, together with sports science, together with all the different aspects of the program. And we have short-term plans, long-term plans, but it's really quite a bit of homework to boil it down to being as simple as possible. But it's something that we work on together with the athletes so that everybody can really trust the plan and stick to it. I'll go through a little bit again more specifically how we plan with our team, but planning is such a huge part, whether it's a seasonal plan, whether it's a camp plan, whether it's a daily plan, whether it's a four-year plan between Olympics. It's such an important part of our business, and I don't really think that you can actually plan too much. And once you have a good plan in place and everybody trusts this, then it's really easy to stick to it, be flexible, of course, but to really stick to that plan. And then, of course, that helps us be prepared and then always have a purpose. when we're on snow with the athletes, whether we're on snow or whether we're doing dry land or whatever, that nothing is done without a purpose then, according to the plan. So we never go out and set a slalom course. We never go out and set a GS course. We go out and set a slalom course at this distance, with this offset, with this number of hairpins, with this number of flushes, with this terrain, with this surface. It's all part of the plan. So planning is something that at younger levels doesn't need to be quite so detailed, but is an extremely important part of developing athletes and programs. Then technical. I'm just gonna hide this idea. There we go. Technically, it's important to really keep the plan simple. We here in Norway, we're quite a simple. I'm not going to go too much into the ski technique side of things, that would take a really long time. But we have quite a simple view of skiing here, and which is really great, because we can boil things down to two or three simple things that we want to target throughout the preparation period, for example. Because skiing takes a lot of time to change. We know that. It's an extremely technical sport, and it takes a lot of time to change. I don't really believe that somebody can improve in one day. I think it takes many days, many repetitions to really make things part of an athlete's scheme. And so that's why it's important on the technical side that we really, again, with a lot of homework behind it, we really boil things down to two or three different things that we want to target through the season. Because of course we can stand at the bottom of the hill, pick out 5, 10, 15 different things that somebody's doing wrong. But then we just start to look left and right and don't really have a good view of where we want to go technically. So, and it's important to just look for those two or three things to change, that you want to change throughout the preparation period. That's how we do it. And I'll, again, go into a little bit more detail after. To really teach and involve the athletes, alpine skiing and feedback should be all as much as possible a two-way conversation. And I know that with my athletes, okay, they're at a slightly different level, but basically the conversation in terms of feedback, it always actually starts with them and how they feel, what they feel. And then I bring what I see into it as well. But it's really important that they're involved and that they're taught of why they're doing something, not just told to do it. I think it's important also to learn how to ski and everything, tough conditions, off-piste. We see it at the World Cup. You'd think that we would have perfect conditions everywhere, but we run into some unbelievable situations that we've actually never seen before. And so the more of a base and the more they know how to ski can help them all over the place. And I think for me, when I watch an athlete ski race, whether it's slalom or giant slalom, that for me, that's not really the mark of how great a skier they are. For me, it's how they ski in powder, how they ski in moguls, and how they ski in rough snow. That's really the mark for me of how good a skier they are. And I think some of the best athletes in the world are beautiful skiers. And however, there are some that are not. And I think most of you would be shocked to watch the free skiing session the day before a World Cup race. But I think that's really important as athletes go through their progress, that it's not just in gates, it's not just ski racing, but it's everywhere. And then I think it's never too early to encourage working together in team-based activities. And so that athletes start to discuss skiing and talk about skiing and help each other with skiing. And we have quite a bit of that with our group. And so we will sit down and video. Sometimes we do it individually, sometimes we do it together, and sometimes the athletes will do it with each other. And so we just try to encourage them working together and doing team-based activities, even though, again, it is an individual sport. Older athletes, long courses, that's something that I've noticed in Norway, is once they reach the fist age, and I think this is very good for later on in their career, they ski really long courses. And it's just simple. It's a simple thing. But it's I think it pays big dividends in the later on in their career. So a lot of the giant slalom races in Norway are minute 15, minute 18 runs with the slalom around the minute or minute five. So I think in terms of preparing them for the future, whether it's NORAM level or whether it's Europa Cup level or whether it's World Cup, I think that's just a little thing that I've noticed in Norway that's been pretty successful. Injury prevention is something that is a challenge in our sport. Our bodies, or particularly our knees, are not exactly designed for what we put them through. And we've had our share of injuries this year, unfortunately, both on the men's and the women's side. But I think it's something that is not discussed that much at the younger age. And I think it becomes, when they get to World Cup or development team, it becomes a little bit of an elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about it. But it's something that is important to talk about. It's part of our sport. It's a high-risk sport, and people do get injured. And I think that with the younger athletes, I don't think it's such a bad thing to start talking about it and let them be comfortable talking about it, so that down the line they have that comfort level. I think it's also interesting to teach athletes what to do in certain situations. I mean, it's clear that if an athlete loses a ski, they're going to fall. But what they do in different situations that can injure an athlete, whether it's getting back off a jump or whether it's getting back through a turn or having the outside ski slide and catch, and lower with athletes what to do in certain situations, because a lot of these accidents can actually be prevented with a little bit of knowledge. One example I have is that I was talking about this to one of the top skiers in the last few years, and she was telling me that when she was younger, she spent a lot of time in terrain parks and went off different jumps and stuff like that. And she was in a World Cup downhill at one point, and she came up on a jump that had a little bit of a lip on it, and her ski kind of got caught there, and her body went a little bit forward. But she said in that instant, she went back exactly to what she had been doing in the terrain park, and I don't know specifically what it was, but she knew in the end exactly what to do. And she 100% believes that if she hadn't had that time in the terrain park, that she wouldn't have known what to do, and that could have ended up badly. So I think that injury prevention, especially, it's a hot topic at the World Cup level these days, and it's I think it's something that is good to look at with the younger athletes in our sport. And then basic technical abilities, I put this down here. I mean, like I said, I don't want to get too much into ski technique, but I mean, if we have an athlete arrive at our European Cup team or even at the World Cup team, and they can ski clean, they can use the legs well, and they're well balanced, then we can do a lot with that. And I think the reason I just wanted to throw this in there was just to, again, highlight that it can be quite simple, that we don't need a ton of different specific things all over the place, that just with a couple of simple, things that they can do well, that they can have quite a bit of success on snow. Coaches learning. I think this is something that's, I mean, we're all here today, which is great. But I think it's really important that we're constantly learning and constantly evolving. I think the day that I feel like I don't want to learn anymore, then that's the day I'm going to stop. And I think it really, we can take all the coaching courses we want in the world. You can listen to me or whoever all we want. But in the end, our sport is by, we learn by doing. And unfortunately, sometimes we learn by doing, making mistakes. And I think the best coaches out there are the ones that are, that dare a little bit to make mistakes, but then own those mistakes at the end and improve. And I think as coaches, we should always be looking at ourselves, of what we're doing, evaluating what we're doing, and really just trying to be better all the time. And I think it's important to dare to be different, dare to be creative. And a few years ago, we had some training leading into the World Cup in Flachau, the slalom in Flachau. And in the days leading up to the races, all the teams are at the venue. And everybody's got, normally there's three lines of training. Every nation is, or each line is assigned to a nation, and then other nations join. And I think we were 2 days before the World Cup race. And I think it was Austria setting one course, Germany setting the other, and us setting the third. And of course, Austria and Germany set their courses, and we went and set stubbies. And everybody looked at us like we were completely insane. But that was part of our plan. And we just wanted to be a little bit different, to be a little bit creative, and it worked out. It worked out pretty well with us. And then to communication between coaches. Our sport is a sport that's full of logistics, budgets, driving, lift tickets, training space, that sort of thing. I think sometimes what gets lost in the discussions is actually the skiing. And I think it's really important to take the time to talk about skiing. And because from my experience, that doesn't happen enough. And so on our team, we set aside quite a bit of time to just to talk about the skiing. And for me, it's personally, it doesn't matter who I talk to. I can talk to my grandmother about skiing, and it's going to start my brain working, and I'll come up with something. And so I think the more we talk about skiing, the better we're going to be, and the more ideas are going to come to the front. That's what I have in terms of some ideas that I feel are important. Some come from my time in Norway, and some not. But then I'd like to go through a little bit how we implement this in our team, and so. Some specific examples, and obviously, some examples may not be appropriate for different teams, but I think it gives you a bit of an idea of how we try and structure the team and how we try and work the team. And hopefully you can take some of these examples and it starts to create some thinking, like we said. But first I thought I'd just take a minute to describe our World Cup team to start. We have a team of 8 athletes this year, all the way from Ragnhild on the screen here, who was a double Olympic medal winner, to a brand new athlete from the European Cup. We have an age spread from born 1989 until year 2000. So we have an 11-year span in our athletes, which is fine, which is great, actually. And so we have 8 athletes. We have 13 staff between service guys, coaches, dry land, that sort of thing. But we train together. We don't have a tech program, and yes, we do have a speed program, but we train everybody together all summer. We, of course, start to split once the winter gets closer. But for example, with Ragnhild, he's extremely focused on giant slalom. And then with Kaiser, the last 2 years, really, I needed to learn how to ski. So we spent a lot of time on giant slalom with her. So basically everybody trains together all summer. We don't split and go in two different places. And again, that goes back to the fact that we feel we're stronger together as a team. Everybody is based in Oslo. Everybody lives here anyways. So everybody's together for the dry land period until the end of June. So we obviously have some staff that don't live here, some coaches, service guys, but all the athletes are grouped together in Oslo. And if they didn't live in Oslo, then they would be required to be here from middle of May until the end of June. So that's just a short description of our team and the group that travels around together. So yeah, our team culture. We have our attacking Viking culture, and that's something that's really been driven home through the organization for quite a number of years now. It's also quite a cool name. And the French team calls themselves the Attacking Croissants, but it's not quite as effective as a name. But basically, the Attacking Viking culture is something that runs through everything we do, whether it's on snow training, whether it's dry land, whether it's analysis work behind the computer, whether it's watering slopes, I don't know. But it's really about working harder than everybody else. It's about training more with more variety. And it's about training with better quality. And I think that's really the definition of the Attacking Viking culture. And they have a saying here in Norway that that comes up quite a bit, that culture eats strategy for breakfast. And I think that this is an area where we feel we can take an advantage on the other teams. At the World Cup level, everybody has good coaches, everybody has good training, everybody has good material. But I think that this is where we feel we can really take an advantage on everybody else, because not everybody has a great culture and not everybody works together team-wise. So I think this is, and it's basically we're the first ones on the hill and we're the last ones off. And I think, like I said, it goes through everything that we do on snow and off snow as well. So the guiding principles of our team then, of our women's team, and I think that when I spoke before about not just necessarily copying the culture of, or copying the programs of other teams or other nations, the same went for us as well. When I arrived in 2014, we had only three athletes with Nina, Løseth, Ragnhild, and Lotte Sejersted. And then in the years before that, I think they had only one or two athletes on the women's team. So there wasn't really a culture there on the women's side. And all I kept hearing in Norway when I arrived was that we had to be like the men's side. And I think that after I thought about that for a while, that just didn't actually fit completely, anyways, with our side. So I think once we started to of course keep many of the same core values, but to forge our own path a little bit was when things started to really take off. And I think what I go through next in terms of the guiding principles of our team and the standards, these are all things that we do as a team, and it's all written down. Everybody has it and everybody buys into it, and because we do it in the end, we do it together. And so what we do with our team is, last week we actually just had what we call our kickoff week. And so part of that is dry land testing, et cetera. But it's also a time when we sit down and have really a big meeting with everybody. And we go through these things together as a group. Like I said, it's written down and that everybody believes in it and buys into it. And so the guiding principles of our team then are quite simple. We're based off performance, teamwork, respect, and professionalism. And those are really the four words that we come back to all the time. And they're the four words that define what our standards are. And so we do have a set of standards on our team. And again, this is a printed set of standards for both the staff and the athletes. And we go through this together as a team. And we really expect each other to hold each other to those standards. Because as a coach, one of the best things you can have is an athlete that makes you better. And so that's the goal of maintaining these standards in our team, that not only are they valuable in terms of performance, but we're there to help the athletes get better, and they're there also to help us get better. So it's something that's clear, it's defined, and everybody goes by these standards. And again, the team that the team comes first. I think that's always part of our culture and our team, that we know that we will get strength from the team. And of course, we have a lot of athletes out there with Schifrin, Volhova, Gut, who essentially are on their own programs, and we get that. But for us and for Norwegians, that doesn't work. And we can see it a little bit in Henrik this year. But our athletes really need to draw on strength from the team. And we feel like we look at other nations, Austria, Switzerland. Yes, they have teams, but they're also very fractured teams, and they don't necessarily gain strength from each other. So again, this is where we feel we can take an advantage. Everyone works together and supports each other. We really look after the people too. Like we're all people, and we look after the well-being of each other comes first. And I think that's also important, because the team is basically our everyday life here. Everybody is, like I said, in Oslo. Of course, we have some people outside, but I think we're really implicated in each other's lives here. And that's an amazing thing to have. So not only do we work and train and work hard together, but if Maria Tveberg needs to move her apartment next weekend, then we're all there. And so we're really implicated in each other's lives, and that's something that's really important for our group. The social aspect. And I think that's something that's also extremely important for us, and also for the team dynamics. I think it's like we have a couple of rules on our team. One of them is that nobody misses dinner. Everybody is at dinner. Whether you're a coach, athlete, service, physio, doesn't matter. Everybody is at dinner. And that's our time to talk. And that's our time to socialize. And that's our time to have fun with each other. And we also, of course, have the rule that we have no phones at dinner, so that there's no distractions. We're just all together. And we spend a lot of time also in the evenings playing games and that sort of thing as a group, because for our girls, this really drives them, actually. And one of the big reasons Ragnhild Movinko won two medals in the 2018 Olympics was not due to any super special preparation that we did. It's, to be perfectly honest, the fact that we played games with her the night before the downhill. And that's extremely important for our athletes and the social aspect of it. And we like to hire people first. When I look to hire coaches or service, I want the person first and I want the coach second. And I think that's I can have someone with a resume a mile long, with I don't know how many World Cup podiums, but if they don't fit into our group and they don't fit into our standards and our values, then no matter how successful that coach has been, they will not succeed here. And so we really hire the people first and the staff second, and the same thing goes for the service guys. It's super easy to pick out a ski technician to hire with lots of experience, but for me, they really have to fit the group first. So we spend a lot of time creating the makeup of our team, not just the athletes, but also the staff. And of course, I'm not Norwegian, clearly, but I do come from a country where there are a lot of foreign coaches. And I feel that for me, it's very important that I hire as many Norwegian coaches as possible, not just to keep the Norwegian culture and speaking the language, but also to develop Norwegian coaches. I think that's really important. Like I said, I know that I'm not Norwegian, but I do know how it is when there are a lot of foreign coaches coming in, sort of parachuting in, I guess, to coach the World Cup team. My goal is really to develop as many Norwegian coaches as possible. And All I need are really good, hardworking people that are willing to learn, and then they will generally be successful. So that's a little bit how we build our culture on the team. It's really fun. It's really fun to be around. It's an amazing group of girls and an amazing group of staff also. Developing athletes on our team. Like I said before, I feel like today's athletes are a little bit different than they used to be. I think that in order to really take that next step, and you know, our goal at the end of the day with our World Cup program is we want to compete for World Cup podiums every weekend in every discipline. We have the athletes to do it, and that in the end is our goal. But for athletes to take that next step to becoming call them serial podium contenders, where they contend every weekend, they really need to do it themselves. And if I look at every athlete out there that's had a great deal of success, it hasn't been because of a coach, it hasn't been because of a service or physio or whatever, it's them that's done it. These athletes will win and podium no matter who is with them. And so it's really important to have them understand and have the ability to take that next step themselves and take the ownership of their program and of their career. And I see, you know, with our athletes at the moment, you know, I see this moving up and up and up in certain athletes, and it's really amazing to watch. You know, the difference with Ragnhild from 4 or 5 years ago to now, you know, she runs her own show, which is amazing to watch, and but that's how it has to be done at that level. We really feel as though it starts with communication. We have a saying on our team that a platform to communicate is a platform to perform. And if and it really starts with that. And so they have to have something to grab onto. They have to have something to own. And they have to. There has to be great communication. And so we have a communications plan then together with the athletes, and we'll go a little bit more into detail in a minute on what these plans are. But their individual programs, the general program came last week, the individual programs at the end of May, our technical plan at the end of July, competition schedules end of August. Race debriefs happen after every race. And then we have what we call check-in meetings. And these are meetings where we sit down and we talk normally once every couple of weeks, and we talk about the team. We don't talk about what's happening the next day or what happened today. We talk about the team and how the team's running or any feedback that we have. We talk about conflict as well quite a bit, because a team that's really close like ours, it's sometimes difficult to face conflict. However, conflict is something that can be quite healthy and end up coming out with a better resolution in the end. I think that's the danger of having a team that's close like ours, is that sometimes we're afraid to have that conflict or afraid to see the results. But in the end, it's something that's necessary and something that we have to face so that things don't build up inside and not get resolved. So this is something that we actually talk about quite a bit together as a group, because for us as a close team, it can be quite a challenge. I can guarantee that Lara Groot has no problem telling Michelle Gazin something that she doesn't want to hear. But within our group, it can be a challenge. So this is something that we talk about quite a bit. So this is how we feel on our team that we really develop athletes. And again, it's not about the left turning left and right. It's not about really the ski technique part of it. That part's actually the easy part. Developing this team and putting these athletes in a position to perform, that's the challenging part. And so this is how we feel we can develop our athletes the best. And if you look, the picture here is Mina Holtman after her podium, her first podium last year in Courchevel. I had a reporter call and ask, and he's like, "Well, what changed for Mina?" It's like, "Well, she changed," and she, you know, and he kept asking me what was responsible for her performance so far that season, and I said, "Well, she is," And she's made the changes, and she really owns her program, owns her scheme, and that's been the big change. It's again, nothing we did, unfortunately. So, but yeah, so that's how we feel we are going to develop the team and our athletes together. I mentioned that planning is a huge part of success in the sport, and success doesn't happen on its own. You really have to plan for it, and that's I think key to the idea of athlete ownership. So that's what they really want to own. If there's a plan for everything, then they can take ownership of that. If there's no plan for certain things, then that's when the ownership kind of goes off the rails, and where an athlete decides to, I don't know, take ownership by not showing up to a session or something like that. But if there's a plan in place then it's really something for them to grab onto and really something for them to own. So we try and have plans for as many things as humanly possible. And also having the plan and believing in the plan is such a key factor in the confidence. And for the athletes to perform at their best, when they're standing at the start gate of Soldin and there's 30,000 people at the bottom and they're about to throw themselves down a minute to 15 GS on that slope, they really want to have the confidence that everything got looked after. And so that's really key for them in terms of their performance. They can ski fast in training all they want, but that doesn't really matter for us. It's how fast they go on races and how they perform at races. And for them to do that, they have to be confident. So in terms of the training plan, we have a general overview. General overview in terms of the season or the preparation season plan. But then we go into quite a bit of detail. So we know approximately what we need before the first World Cup races in each season, whether it's Soldin, whether it's Levy, whether it's Lake Louise on the ski. So then we go through our camp plan and our training plan, and we look at exactly where we're going to get those session numbers, the volume numbers. We know from past experience that sessions in X location give us this volume and Y location give us that volume. And so we go into quite a bit of detail in terms of where we're going to get the volume and where we're going to get the session numbers. And then we can have a very detailed plan for the preparation period. And then we can adjust as we go if we're getting a little bit more of something here or a little bit less of something there. But we know that we're going to arrive in Soldin with at least 25 sessions of GS and somewhere between 55 and 6,500 gates. We know that we're going to arrive in Levy with 25 sessions and around 10,000 stalling gates. And then we can track everything, of course. The lower picture is our tracking so that I know exactly how many runs we've done, how many days we've skied, the percentage of sessions, who set the courses, or who's been the majority course setter, what were the snow conditions, different terrain, course turning is also then cut off as the different snow conditions, so that we can then really evaluate it and adjust the plan if we need. But that's the level of detail then that we go into making the general training plan. And that's something that then we sit down with each athlete and look through and make adjustments according to what they feel they need, what they feel they want, and what they feel is going to bring them success. So this is not something that we present to them and say, this is how it is. This is something that this is a starting point that we sit down and discuss with each of them. Then the technical plan, we create then a technical plan for the summer of what we want to achieve on snow. Like I mentioned before, those two or three things that we feel are going to make us faster. And that basically takes quite a bit of time. And so we go through and analyze the entire World Cup season, which will take until about the end of June. And then through that, we start to see trends and we start to see Where we are strong and where we maybe need to improve and what's going to really take us to that next level. So then we sit down, we create the technical plan, and then we present it to the athletes. And this is what we want to do. This is why. Here's the video of it. And through our analysis, actually, here's the proof. And so just as an example, one or two years ago, going through the analysis of the slalom season, I came to the discovery that hairpins, for example, in slalom, which now we're seeing in the World Cup, 6, 7, 8 hairpins per race, that they're actually extremely important to create speed. And their hairpins are not just what many people consider them to be, as just as a way to lose the race if you make a mistake, but they're actually somewhere where we can actually create a lot of speed. And we came out with specific examples from our analysis with the proof and brought that to the athletes, and then everybody's on board. And so that summer, part of our technical plan was to target hairpins. And that was very successful in the end. So we try and keep it fairly simple. Of course, there's different paths to what, to achieve the goal, but we really try and keep it to a couple of things that we want to target so that we can, by the time we're in the start gate in Solon or in Levy in Lake Louise, those changes are part of their scheme and we don't sit there and wonder if it's going to happen or not. So that's presented then to the athletes at the end of July before we really start the on-snow part of the program. The camp plans then together, the staff comes together 1 week before every camp. And we make a detailed plan for the camp day by day, what we want to achieve, how we want to do it, what slopes we want to use. Of course, things can change with weather, but we have a very detailed plan in place and that we present to each athlete individually. And then we make little adjustments on an individual basis for each athlete. And then the daily plan, we sit down every day. I think for us and for a lot of coaches, I think the most important work happens in the afternoon. And the skiing obviously is important, but really the most important work happens in the afternoon, how we evaluate the day and what we did well and making the plan for the next day. And so when we get off snow at a training camp, then before we are ready to present a video to athletes, to do video with athletes, between analysis and different things that we do, it's about a 3-hour process before we are actually ready to bring the video then to the athletes. And so that's extremely important for us. And then we are able to sit down together with the athlete and then go through the day and then make the plan for the next day. Then as coaches, we sit down every evening and we discuss every athlete. We go through and discuss in detail then every athlete, because maybe one coach had been working with somebody one day and so that everybody is communicating as much as possible and that everybody is, I hate this phrase, but on the same page. And so that's how we go into then our daily plan. Then in terms of the competition season planning, this is not in a huge amount of detail, but we can talk all we want about peaking for major events, whether it's Olympics or World Championships, and go through the different yearly training cycle or whatever. But the fact of the matter is that we need to perform every weekend. We can't let World Cup season go and then all of a sudden expect to perform at the Olympics. That's just not going to happen. So it's really important for us to prepare and to plan for variety in the intensity of the season. I think it's really easy once you get into the World Cup season to try and stay at that 100% level of intensity. But slowly that 100% level of intensity starts to degrade, starts to go down. And you're really no longer able to achieve that 100%. So the way we deal with that then is to really plan for variation in intensity. So we make a plan to build for every single race. So the example I used in Flachau before earlier was an example of just that. So if we have a race coming up on the weekend, Saturday, Sunday, World Cup, then maybe Monday, we go through in basic technical work, whether it's stubbies, free skiing, that sort of thing. Tuesday, bring that into race courses, but not with timing necessarily. Wednesday, we bring it in with timing and go full. Thursday, we're off, and then Friday is the free skiing and before the race training. So so we really try and plan for variety or variation in intensity. And I think that's also something that should happen all over. Instead of just going out and setting courses and putting up the timing, standing at the bottom and in feedback, I think it's really important that we build variety into it in the intensity. So that's super important for us. Then also with the competition season, we have, in terms of when we go through the analysis for the technical plan, then I'm also able to prepare a file, I guess, on each race slope. So where the important points were, where the most time was won and lost, so that we have a file on each race slope that we do. Of course, if we go somewhere new, then we don't have that. But some of the venues we go to year after year, then we build this file with our analysis and again, examples and proof. And then we go through with the athletes before getting to that venue, okay, these are the important parts. And then it will also affect sometimes where we train and how we train leading into that event. As an example, would be Solden. Solden is a steep, long, scary GS. And everyone looks at that and all everyone talks about is the pitch, but actually the race is won and lost on the bottom flat. And we know that. And we saw that in our analysis. That's something that we picked out for the athletes. And then we were able to, when I say it's won and lost on the lower flat, it's depending on how many gates up you can sort of let go and take that speed then all the way across the flat. And so one of our big things for the race in Solden was exactly where we have that let go point or where we want to take the speed onto the flat. And that was something in both runs that we focused on and that came out of our analysis that we did. And again, it worked out quite okay for us. So that's just something that we also have then for planning in the competition season. But again, I think it's just anything we can make a plan for, we basically do. And then having the athletes as part of that plan and them developing that together with us creates a really good ownership of their program. So, technical again. Like I mentioned a couple times now before, we look for these two or three points that that we feel are going to give us the biggest jump. I think in the hairpin example was one, but I think that it's important for not only for everybody to be clear on the goals, okay, that what we want to accomplish, but also clear on the steps of how to get there. And that's both the athletes and all of the coaches as well. Because we want this to be a process through the summer. For me, it doesn't really matter how fast they ski in August. It matters how fast they ski on October 23rd. And so it's really important that everybody understands the steps and the benchmarks and what we want to achieve step by step. Because I'll have people ask me all the time after we come back from a camp in, I don't know, August. The first question always is, how are the girls skiing? And I'm just like, I usually answer with, I have no idea, actually. I don't know yet. But we're just building step by step. I think it's really important for everyone to be aware of those steps because that's what we look for in the skiing. That's what we look for in the video, not the finished product. That happens later. We look for the steps that we want to build. And that's equally important for the coaches as it is for the athletes. Because because the first thing that an athlete does when she sees the video is, wow, I look shitty. But it's actually not the case because you're accomplishing this, this, and that, which is what we had set out to do, which is a building block to get into where we want to go. So I think it's really important for the not only the end goal to be defined, but the path to get there. Of course, different paths are possible or for different athletes, but the goals remain the same. And again, we feel as though variety is extremely important in our training. And we can be targeting similar goals, but we try and do it in a number of different ways. So the athletes are exposed to as many different challenges, I guess you can say, as possible. And then I talked about the work in the afternoon and then the race load preparation. But again, this is not down into the details of skiing, but it's really how we go about how we go about it, which in my mind is the most important, actually. Then, yeah, how we develop coaches on our team. I think that nobody can be here if they're not going to own up to their mistakes, own their mistakes, and get better from them. And I think that that's really how we improve as coaches. Also from feedback from each other and feedback from the athletes. I think it's very important that we're honest with each other. It can sometimes be uncomfortable, but that we're honest with each other and we talk really about how we're working both as individuals and as a team. To give an example, through April, then we had quite a few meetings, just the coaches team on the women's side, and discussing how we can be better. And I think this year in the Corona situation, it was mind-blowingly difficult. And not only did our team find our limit, but we blew like completely through it. But it also exposed, and I think it would be easy for us as coaches to look back on the season and say, that was a tough one, Corona. Well, that's not going to happen again. But it's important that we understand that it actually exposed some weaknesses. It exposed some weaknesses in how we function as a group and how we function as individuals. And so we sat down together with coaches, and we did actually, I tallied it all up between 4 or 5 days, we did 19 hours of meeting, just talking to each other about how we can be better with specific examples, uncomfortable conversations, but really evaluating how we can be better. And then for me, it's important we take all that feedback that we, of course, there's lots of positive things, but we tend to spend time on the things that we can improve. But it's important that we take that information then and really use it. Use it to improve as coaches, and because all we want to do is make the athletes better or help make the athletes better. And then I have basically each coach, each of us then at our meetings with the athletes, presents some of that feedback, some of individual ways that we are going to be better. And then the athletes, they do that as well. They do the same. And so we really are trying to learn from each other and to push each other to be the best we can. It's important that we use each staff member to its full potential. I think when the team grows and the staff grows, it's quite easy for people to be, just there. And I think it's important that we look at each staff member that we have and we challenge them and we use them to their full potential. Otherwise, then you have people that are around the team that aren't excited necessarily to be there, and this ends up bringing the team down in terms of their effect on the whole group. So it's really important for us to go through each staff member and keep them challenged and keep them learning to use them to their full potential. One of the reasons I love being in Norway is the sports science. We do and we don't have a big sports science department. We, in terms of the number of people that are there, we don't. It's one. But in terms of what we do with it, it's huge because he works unbelievably hard and is insanely smart. And so one of the reasons that I love being there is the sports science, because we are continually doing our own research and trying to push things forward, whether it's in ski technique, a bunch of different areas. But and we do everything on our own. We don't rely on anybody from the outside. We don't rely on any outside software, with the exception of Dartfish. We basically do and build everything on our own, and it's extremely interesting. And I love that because I love to learn, and it's really cool, to be honest. And we're obviously trying to evolve the sport and constantly look for advantages on other teams, but at the end of the day, we're basically just all nerds and we really like that stuff. So our main focus at the moment is with GPS work, analysis software development. So we have our own analysis software that we've built, and then suit and fabric aerodynamics. So those are basically the three main. There's a few other little things here and there, but those are the three main things we're looking at the moment in sports science. And so the GPS work and then the analysis software, it gives us some really incredible tools to figure out how to go faster. And so personally, I find that extremely, extremely interesting. And then we developed with technical meetings also. So we set aside time that is not, like I said before, to talk about logistics or to talk about this or that. It's time that we talk about skiing. And we not only do that together as a group, but we do that together with the men's coaches as well. And so we spend a lot of time working all together and looking at the different angles. Yeah, there's often some solid arguments, but that's how it needs to be. So that we really sit down and look at the nuts and bolts of the ski technique and what we want to accomplish together. And then, yeah, working together. I mean, we want to help each other. The sentence, that isn't my job, doesn't exist on this team. So we do everything together, whether it's the service guys helping us shovel or water a slope, or whether it's us helping them load and unload ski rooms. And so we work together as a team. We do everything together as a team. But then in the end, we just really have to have fun together. It's obviously a serious business, especially at the top level, but in the end, it's really fun. And we have to have fun together as a group. We have to enjoy each other. We have to take the time to have that fun. And because we spend a lot of time together, and if it's not fun, it's not going to work. So that's how we feel we develop coaches on our team. And so that's about it, what I have for now. Well, not for now, I'm not bringing anything else later, but that's what I have for now. So I hope you were able to take one or two things from that, and I'd definitely love to answer some questions.
All right, Tim, thank you very much. Really interesting. I think we took some notes. I guess the coaches also took some notes. We were a little bit jealous of your ski facilities this morning. It was so nice to see that in this actual morning. So that's great. Nice tips on coaching. I love the team gathering every dinner without the phones. That's a good thing. But also the plans that you have all through the season with the athletes. And I guess it's really helpful for our coach and ski system. We have some questions from Francis Royal. When you look back to your coaching years in our system, what would you bring in priority to your team culture, values, approach, knowing that Canadians are different than Norwegians?
You mean like if from my time in Canada, sorry?
Well, yeah, when you look back at your coaching years and our system, so the values are different. I could maybe switch a little bit the question by saying, what was the biggest adjustment for you as a Canadian coaching now Norwegian athletes?
Yeah, I don't think there was actually a huge adjustment. You know, when I left the Canadian team, we had a really great group, really fun group with some athletes that are, of course, still there. And so I think the big thing that changed for me when I moved to Norway was that I got the chance to build a program, build something. And to be perfectly honest, I took a lot.
From the Canadian, okay.
How I did that.
Or how
I helped do that. And so for me, that was really the biggest change. And I went from being a tech coach to, you know, having, you know, not a blank slate, but almost a blank canvas. And so that was cool.
Okay. We have a question here. In Canada, it seems we have many athletes dropping out of ski racing, entering FIST, and have limited pass, U18 pass. It has not changed since you left. Other than elite, we are elite skiers. We are very limited past U18, under 18. Can you comment on how we can help keep that group in ski racing? Keep the ladies and the gentlemen in the racing groups.
Yeah, that's a question that comes up every time I do one of these. I don't know actually the magical answer. Okay. Obviously, the cost is a huge factor. For North Americans, it's not that easy to travel and to ski. And I think the bar keeps getting raised all the time in terms of what athletes at certain ages are supposed to be doing, I guess. And so I think the cost is one thing, and but I think it's difficult to keep them engaged all the time, I guess. Young, I think we're so serious so quickly, and I think that
too much.
Yeah, I think so, in my opinion. And not only then does the development of the skiing itself suffer, but then really the motivation and the drive. I mean, not everybody has the drive to be one of the best in the world. That's clear. But the more athletes we have, the more chances we give ourselves. And I think athlete retention is an issue everywhere. It's also an issue in Norway here as well. And on the women's side, we don't have a huge pool of athletes to draw from that are on the way. And,
okay.
So it's really an issue everywhere. So I think trying to mitigate the cost as much as possible, I think that finding a creative solution. And of course, I thought long and hard about showing that slide of the glacier this morning, because then everyone's going to think that we need to ski, but that's actually not the case. That just happens to be convenient for us to be there.
That's right. Yeah.
And so, you know, athletes that are super young, they don't need to ski. They need to develop in like a ton of other sports, and they really need to be hungry to go skiing. And when the time comes, and
I don't so really... you favor the multi-sport training, like okay,
mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Great. Okay, Philippe.
Even as simple as a 13-year-old that's already been to Chile, already been to Europe, already been to New Zealand. I mean, then what's left? And so then I think the motivation and the drive starts to go down. So I really think that keeping the cost as low as possible and then trying to keep them engaged.
I'm happy. Okay. Je peux résumer rapidement. C'est ça. La question était comment on fait pour garder nos filles 18? Ou nos filles ou nos garçons, en fait, nos skieurs, parce que, bon, c'est le gap entre le régional, si on veut, le provincial, puis là, l'équipe nationale est très grand. Mais c'est de les garder heureux, mais aussi baisser les coûts, évidemment, c'est une question de coûts souvent, mais les garder heureux, puis pas toujours en ski. Donc, de garder la passion présente. Alors, ils croient beaucoup, entre autres, U13 et U14, c'est pas nécessaire d'avoir fait plein de camps à travers le monde. C'est ça, de garder, donc, la passion lorsque c'est le temps de mettre nos skis. Philippe Duchesne, what kind of GPS app you use?
Not telling. No, we have our own system.
Secret.
Yes. Through our sports science department, then we've developed a GPS system that we've used for quite a few years.
Okay.
It's a little large it was a little large until a little while ago, so we had quite a project to miniaturize this GPS. So we have that our own, basically, our own system and then our own analysis software to, okay, deal with it. So we don't use like ProTurn, for example, or anything like that.
Okay. Ils ont leur propre système GPS en Norvège. Oui, Hugo, je te vois. J'imagine que tu veux...
Well,
on a une question de Mario Gagnon là, que je vais lui laisser la poser.
Ah oui, live. Ben, allons-y. C'est bon, c'est merci, Hugo.
Bon, alors, Mario.
Mario Gagnon.
Tu as juste enlevé ton mio puis posé ta question.
C'est bon.
Est-ce qu'on m'entend bien?
Très bien.
Et... Hi, team. Long time no see. You started your career as an Antique Wing coach here in Ottawa. And you made all your way to the national team level as a coach. So that gives you a unique perspective on the path from the U12 on Nancy Green level all the way to the national team for the athletes. Can you give us the biggest difference for the between the Canada's structure and the Norway structure as a U12, U16, at the U12, U16 level?
Good question.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. Of course, when I started, it was K1 and K2. yeah, I mean, I'll be perfectly honest. I mean, I'm not super immersed in that system here in Norway. But I do think that, yeah, it's to be honest, really hard for me to say. But I think because it's been also so long since I've been at that level or I've been at that age group in Canada. So I think, Mario, like if I was to give you an answer, I'm not sure it would be a great one because I'm really not sure. Sorry.
That's okay. This is a tough question.
I do not bullshit my way through it.
That's right. Great. We have a question here. What are the biggest social difference between Quebec and Norway?
Well, I think, that's a really good question, I think. To be honest, I see maybe more similarities between Quebec and Norway. I think that Quebec is also a culture where sport is very important and outdoor activity is very important. And, Quebec is similar to Norway, and then it's full of these really cool little ski hills all over the place. And also, I think that the language is a huge similarity as well. Obviously, not the language itself, but the fact that Quebecers as well as Norwegians are extremely proud of the language they speak, and that it's a huge part of their culture. So, I think that. There's a lot of similarities, actually, that I would say between Quebec and Norway. Okay. The difference is a little bit. I think things are sometimes a little simpler here, through the development. And Mario, this could also partly answer your question, is that things in Norway through those age groups are I think, much simpler. And there's, like I said before, there's really no selections. And so there's nothing... how do I say this? There's no, penalties for bad performances or that sort of thing. So I think things are a little bit more low key through that age group, as mm-hmm. it is maybe in Quebec.
Okay, that's interesting, man.
Or really sometimes, good. Or I could also say the rest of Canada. I don't know.
Okay.
But also, I think, Norwegian are unbelievably slow drivers, and Quebec is fast drivers. So, that's a
social difference. That's nice. I could ask a question that goes a little bit with your answer. I guess if one day you come back in Canada or in Quebec as a coach, what would you bring back from Norway that could help us? If you have a tip or two, the things that you can bring back in Canada,
well,
that you learned there. Yeah,
I think that. Quite a bit of what I just finished presenting, I think I would definitely bring to Canada. Obviously, there are different challenges in Canada that we don't have in Norway.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of pure geography, for example.
Distance, yeah.
You know, I think that you know, a lot of that, you know, team culture building would be important. I think also for me, we have not done in Canada, it has not been a great job of developing, you know, Canadian coaches, and so I think that that's that's a huge thing that needs to happen.
Wow.
Because, you know, that's also part of why I have Norwegian coaches, is because as much as we want to say that we can, I mean, I will never fully understand Norwegians and Norwegian culture, nor will a foreigner ever fully understand Canadian culture or Quebec culture. So I think that's important. And then also it's, we need to, in Canada, it's important for us to develop athletes for the country of Canada. It's not important for us to develop athletes for the province of Quebec or the province of Ontario or the province of BC or Alberta. We have to develop athletes for the country of Canada. Because at the end of the day, the sport is a European sport. It's done on a world stage. And at the end of the day, we want Canadian athletes. It doesn't matter where they come from. We want those Canadian athletes to be successful. And so I think I would really try and bring a little bit more of that into the ski racing culture in Canada.
Oh, okay.
We have to be proud. There's one thing in Norway is that people are extremely proud. They're proud to be Norwegian. They're proud to be representing Norway. And we're very proud of that. And so are the coaches in the trenches, I guess, in the clubs and in the ski gymnasiums. And all they want to do really is produce athletes for the country of Norway.
Intéressant. Je lui demandais qu'est-ce qu'il ramènerait au Canada s'il avait la chance un jour d'être entraîneur, encore une fois, entraîneur au Canada ou au Québec. Mais il dit vraiment de développer les athlètes pour le Canada, d'être vraiment un sentiment d'appartenance, une fierté canadienne, plus qu'une fierté provinciale. Et puis aussi de développer les entraîneurs au Canada, parce qu'il, quand même qu'il est en Norvège, la culture norvégienne, il ne l'aura jamais finalement toujours, il ne l'aura pas assimilé autant que s'il était lui-même un Norvégien. Alors, de développer les entraîneurs québécois et canadiens, c'est une priorité. Et je pense qu'on a plusieurs personnes qui vont sans doute être d'accord. Est-ce qu'on y va pour une dernière question, Eric et Hugo? Hein, ça va? Alain Rondeau, last one. In Norway, do you have any government participation to lower the cost of the ski programs at club level or national?
Not really, no.
Not really, eh? Okay.
And that's a little counterintuitive, because as I just finished describing with a country that sport is so important, that we would have a serious amount of government help, but that's not the case.
Okay.
And we do have a minor amount, and some of our projects that we do through the Olympic Committee or Olympiatoppen, which is the
on the podium kind of program.
It's not quite like on the podium, but it's Olympiatoppen is the Olympic Training Center, and so okay. We use quite a bit of staff for different areas of dryland, for example.
Okay,
and we have different expertise there. And so that is funded partially anyways by the government.
Okay.
As a team, we do not really get help from the government at all. And that's, you know, in terms of what we do with the budget that we have and the money that we have, I'm pretty sure we'd be number one, because everybody looks at Norway and it's a European nation. It has a history of success in the sport.
Yeah, of course. But
our budget for sure is smaller than Canada's budget.
Wow.
So it's very challenging. And we have Norwegian sponsors, and like I said before, cross country is an absolute religion here. And so a lot of the, you know, private sector money goes there as well.
Okay. But you told me before the conference that even then, with what you just explained, it's cheaper to ski at local level in Norway and Canada.
Yeah, that's for sure. Okay. That's for sure. I mean, athletes, with the exception of going to Sweden for some races, which is anyways by car, athletes don't really travel out of Norway for their first races until they go to European Cup races.
Okay.
Well. And they don't generally travel out of Norway for ski training until they're at least FIS age.
Okay.
So, but for the younger ones, the cost is quite a bit lower.
Okay, that's a good thing. Alors, c'est un peu moins cher de skier en Norvège qu'ici pour les parents canadiens. C'est ça la question. Il n'y a pas vraiment d'aide gouvernementale, pas plus que nous, d'ailleurs, de ce côté-là. Alors, c'est, voilà la question. Puis, un dernier point, peut-être, avant de laisser la parole à nos amis, Eric et Hugo. Ben, there's a comment, not a question, but a just big thanks to Tim for sharing the experience. Good work, and come home soon. We need people like you.
Thanks, Joey.
Hugo, merci, Tim. Thanks very much. This was really interesting. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Ouais, vraiment intéressant. Il nous disait, entre autres, en terminant, moi, je trouve ça très drôle, il disait, tu sais, les challenges sont différents, mais il dit, nous autres, en Norvège, entre autres, on a maintenant un règlement qui interdit, parce qu'on parlait des fois, les parents dans le monde du coaching, des fois, ça peut être un challenge, mais il dit, en Norvège, c'est pire, parce qu'entre autres, on vient d'instaurer un règlement qu'on n'a pas le droit d'atterrir un hélicoptère à moins de 100 mètres d'une ligne d'arrivée. C'est ça que j'ai compris?
Private helicopter, yeah.
Alors, il y a quand même des challenges un peu différents. Merci infiniment, Tim. Ça nous amène à la conclusion de cette première partie de deux aujourd'hui. À 13h, le sport bien-être présenté par Patrick Vachon et Alexandre Berry. Je pense que le ski alpin québécois doit être très fier que sport bien-être et sport tête, c'est d'abord né avec la Fédération québécoise de ski alpin. Et puis, Patrick Vachon va nous parler un peu des choses qui ont été implantées depuis maintenant quelques années pour un sport adapté à tous et un sport sécuritaire et où le bien-être est important également. Alors voilà.
Merci. Thanks again, Tim.
Super. Thank you. Merci.
Bye.
Merci, Tim. Au revoir.
On se revoit à 1h, tout le monde.
13h.
Merci.
C'est bon. Au revoir.